I'm going to thank, my name is David Altheide, and it's a real pleasure to be here. I want to thank the organizers of the conference, Green College, for putting on this extraordinary symposium in Richard's honor. It's wonderful, again, to see Diana. Carla and I visited Green College in the mid-1990s, and it was a wonderful experience. And since then, I became so enthralled with UBC that I feel even more invested. One of my former students is now teaching on the Okanagan campus, and so we've learned more about the whole UBC setup. And I rather wish that much of what we're doing in the United States would follow some of the things going on at UBC, and especially Green College. So it's terrific to be here. What I want to talk a little bit about this morning is the importance of how a mediated social order is successful in passing on certain social definitions about crisis and especially fear, and how important this becomes for institutional change over a period of time. I'm particularly interested in my remarks this morning to focus a bit on how the discourse of fear, particularly following 9/11 and the concerted propaganda campaigns, have been successful in changing American university culture, particularly the role of social sciences in becoming stronger advocates for what I would call the sort of the military industrial order, the military media complex. One of Richard's lasting contributions was providing an understanding of how institutional control and domination emerge from organizational innovations, often in times of crisis, punctuated by various narratives of risk. He demonstrated how institutional logics delineated the origin, nature, communicative forms, formats, and consequences of bureaucratic reasoning on a range of significant sociological topics, especially power and social control. Indeed, as many of you realize, the reason I study mass media is because I've been puzzling for decades about developing a more general theory of power and social control. And one cannot discuss such things, in my view, these days without considering the role of the mass media in defining situations. I want to explore a bit, and there is a paper behind this, so I've pulled out a few things, how the military defense industries have been marketed, pursued, and embraced by social sciences in many American universities. And I wish to specifically raise some issues surrounding the recent pursuit of academic advice and legitimacy following the 9/11 terror attacks on the United States, supported by the rhetoric of a never-ending battle against terrorism, government and military power brokers invited and paid, and academics joined in the fight against terrorism. Fear continues to be a significant cultural meaning in entertainment, politics, and critical reflections, even humor. Some of you may recall Lex Luthor, Superman's nemesis, who seemed to understand a great deal about power and social control and fear. But what have we learned from Pogo? What have we learned from Lex Luthor? This was an ad that appeared in a recent ASU alumni magazine. This glossy production invited applicants to be part of the National Clandestine Service, with a picture of a toppling of Saddam Hussein statue in Baghdad. And in interest of time, I must curtail the digression here, but this is really quite fascinating because, in fact, this statue was pulled down by the U.S. military and some of their stooges in Baghdad at the time. They couldn't even get enough people in Baghdad to actually pull it down. This was what some of the fine print says in the ad. Americans watching about an hour of news daily, join the CIA, live it live 24/7. Be part of the history in the making as a national clandestine service officer. This is no ordinary assignment. It is a mission of importance. It is how you make a difference for our nation. The military intelligence community has had more presence on U.S. campuses since 9/11, especially the last 5 or 6 years. The CIA has actually been involved in 2 recruiting conferences, explicitly defined as such, at ASU's campus. And one of the speakers at the conference was a spokesperson for the Navy, and I was inspired by his PowerPoint presentation, which included a photo of an aircraft carrier, which he said, we use these to help people in other countries in times of crisis. And a recent slogan actually featured the U.S. Navy, a force for good. So some of you liberals who have a different idea, you should consider such things in mind. Richard said, and his students and co-authors said a lot about risk and social control, as Aaron Doyle has so nicely captured this morning. One of the statements that I particularly like, a combination of a couple of paragraphs in the interest of time, coercive control gives way to contingent categorization. Collective fear and foreboding underpin the value system of the unsafe society, perpetuate insecurity, and feed demands for more knowledge of risk. Life is to be made most real and livable by risk technologies that tame chance in the landscape of fear. Universities, especially social scientists, can help with the knowledge of risk. At least this is how it's been marketed. There's been an ongoing interest in developing and building on the politics of fear, which are really quite important in the United States today, as many of you know, and in fact has become a sort of a rallying cause for kind of a renewed nationalism in the United States. Virtually all of the significant political parties subscribe to the politics of fear. Virtually no important political candidate speaks against our wars and some of the paths that we have chosen. Individuals that occasionally raise questions about even why 9/11 really happened are often shouted down and get in a great deal of difficulty. Today, virtually all U.S. institutions resonate military logic and discourse about fear, threat, and terrorism. Over the years, we've been tracking how the language of the military finds itself in to other institutions, including religion and education. The emphasis has been fueled by the military media complex, which refers to the use of military sources, frames, discourse, and logic in mass media reports about wars, problems, conflicts, and issues. The military media complex is a feature of programming in an entertainment era dominated by popular culture and communication forms that share sophisticated information technology, promoting visual media and evocative content. Institutional practices increasingly incorporate and reflect these politics. The secret world has emerged in the United States in terms of government, and I mention these things as a prelude to talking about specific activities social scientists have been involved with. Policing and social control at home and abroad have dominated public perceptions and contributed to the expansion of the national defense rhetoric and surveillance and control throughout social life. U.S. government splurge on war machinery and expanded surveillance organizations and technology after 9/11. Journalists have been appalled, dismayed, and confounded in their efforts to try to track some of this. This is one summary of some of the things that have been discovered by some New York Times investigators that you might have seen some of their reports. After 9 years of unprecedented spending and growth, we know this much. Some 1,271 government organizations and nearly 2,000 private companies work on programs related to counterterrorism, homeland security, and intelligence in over 10,000 locations across the country. Indeed, the Times investigators found no fewer than 33 separate buildings have been put up in the Washington, D.C., Maryland area alone. An estimated 854,000 people hold top secret security clearances. Many agencies do the same work, creating redundancy and waste. For example, 51 federal organizations operating in 15 U.S. cities track the flow of money to and from terrorist documents. Analysts who try to make sense out of these documents, try to interpret them as they see, try to filter them and refine them, what does it all mean, have essentially almost given up in dismay because nobody can seem to keep track of what's in the 50,000 reports that are filed each year. Many of them are simply ignored. To say we're engaged in data overload is to put it mildly. But welcome to the National Security University. I define the National Security University as a generic composite of direct relationships between the national security agencies and university administrations, academic programs, research support and agendas, as well as special academic lectures, colloquia, etc. Historically, the engineering and physical sciences have always been part of the military-industrial academic complex that radical Republican President General Dwight David Eisenhower warned us about as he was leaving office. Eisenhower cautioned us in statements that later on C. Wright Mills and many other social scientists would pick up on about the growing power of this complex. The universities have basically joined up on this, especially social sciences. Again, historically, the engineering sciences, the physical sciences involved in weapons development, especially prior to World War II, but certainly after World War II, have been key to the development of even physics in the United States, if not most of the world. But the social sciences and humanities were usually not very closely involved, partly because they didn't seem to have a great deal to offer the battle. There's several steps in this, and we'll get into some of the programs in a summative kind of way. One of the things involved is a broad effort to brand and market the military. 9/11 made this much, much easier to do, but the effort had started long before that, as we noted in some of our early work. One of the things that's been very popular in the last several years is actually the military brand. That's been used, and here you get some of the statements. Well, let me show you some of the visuals of specifically a very small part, camo clothing, camouflage clothing. I first noticed this after the first Gulf War. Some of you might remember way back then, when one of the things that came online then and became very popular was the Humvee. And the Humvee began selling, it became sort of a signature vehicle for the victory in Kuwait. And the Humvee then sold for a paltry something like $65,000 a shot in the States. That was too much, so the car manufacturers very creatively developed smaller versions of the Humvee with slightly smaller engines. And the payload was less. And then one of the things that became very popular in the United States was this, the photo down in the lower left-hand corner of the stretch limo Humvee, which are quite popular in the Phoenix area. That is until gas started crossing $4 a gallon. And but when you add the camo bit to the stretch limo, you get a really fascinating sense of the sort of the marketing and how it enters the culture. Students who use semioticians have a real ball with this this sort of thing that's going on. But here you get a statement from a merchandiser about how the armed forces since Vietnam have become very, very, very significant in a lot of the marketing. The Army is one of the most unique brands on the market right now, said a manager for a large advertising company. Consumers have a strong affinity and a great pride for what the U.S. Army stands for. One of the things that was fascinating after the Gulf War, especially the first Gulf War, you may remember, is that it became so popular because the U.S. was so successful in the first Gulf War. Military-wise, there were very few casualties, very few deaths. As a matter of fact, some analysts suggested that more women serving in the military became pregnant than soldiers had actually lost their lives in that campaign. So, of course, we must have something for the babies as well. So here you can do an entire room now and start people off in a very, very young age. The old and the new military approach to social science. I mentioned already about historically the role of the university in research and arms and so forth, but prior to certainly the Vietnam War, the social sciences were heavily involved with military, especially political science, polling, propaganda campaigns against the enemy and so forth. There's a rich literature on all that. But then the Vietnam War happened, and this really altered a lot of the perceptions and interest of social scientists. The Vietnam War, the civil rights movement made a very big difference in social science interest, especially among students. Another thing that happened is, as I mentioned again, is that the social sciences didn't really directly benefit from war expenditures because there wasn't much support apart from some intelligence officers for what social science had to offer. Third, many social scientists actually rejected government use of researchers for activities that they had learned about, particularly clandestine operations. And one of these, the first ones, the most popular ones, was Project Camelot. Do any of you recall this? Any of you remember? Someone's out there? Project Camelot was very important, as it's been written a lot by a lot. It became very, 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 very significant. In a statement, former Secretary of Defense Gates kind of referred to the problem with social scientists in the military. He said, just a couple of statements, despite success in the past and present, it's an unfortunate reality that many people believe that there's a sharp divide between academia and the military, that each continues to look on the other with a jaundiced eye. These feelings are rooted in history, and I mentioned some of this, and he's hoping this can change. What Project Camelot basically did, and in the few minutes I really can't fully capture it, I'll skip some of the real long descriptions, but just part of it. It was really an attempt to use social scientists and particularly anthropologists in counter-revolutionary research in Chile in the 1960s. And ultimately, when it was found out about it, was canceled in 1965. But a lot of the activities in Project Camelot were critical in propping up and supporting the Pinochet regime and a lot of the terror and horror that came out of that. A CIA description of the Project Camelot at the time said, it's an outgrowth of the interplay of many factors and forces. Among these is the assignment in recent years of much additional emphasis to the U.S. Army's role in the overall U.S. policy of encouraging steady growth and change in the less developed countries in the world, in Chile at the time. The many programs the U.S. government directed toward this objective are often grouped under the sometimes misleading label of counterinsurgency. Some pronounceable term standing for insurgency prophylaxis would be better, etc. It was canceled in 1965. It became known. Social scientists were outraged that they had been involved, their disciplines had been involved, their knowledge, their researchers had been involved in such activities, and out of this came a number of ethical guidelines that most of the major social sciences subscribe to. And one of a number of researchers have written about this. One of the most troubling aspects of the Project Camelot controversy was a realization on the part of many scholars of, quote, the extent to which they were accepting and supporting the premises of official policy when they undertook military-sponsored research, no matter how basic the investigation. For a long time, that was kind of a standard awareness about the role of social science and the government and the military, that they wouldn't mix very well because there were certain, forgetting the ideological slant, there were certain disciplinary, ethical guidelines about a researcher subject relationships, protection of human subjects, etc., that would not go. But now, some 50 years later, back to the future. Many universities in the United States embrace military discourse and goals. This would surely make Richard grin after everything that had happened. ROTC programs have been added on many campuses throughout the United States. Several have been brought back, such as Harvard, Stanford, and Columbia. Arizona State actually offered Navy ROTC, even though we're in the desert, you know, sort of do it all. One of the things that helped was when the military finally sort of renounced the don't ask, don't tell approach, you know, and so this was one thing. Universities make a lot of money from ROTC programs, of course, but in addition, there were other things that the government offered millions of dollars to start some research. And one multi-million dollar center was established at the University of Maryland, the National Consortium for the Study of Terrorism Responses to Terrorism. Heralding this accomplishment was a statement published in the Sociology Newsletter Footnotes by the appointed director, Gary LaFree. And he said, quote, this grant to the University of Maryland may be the social science equivalent of the Manhattan Project. We'll be a kind of academic rapid response team. Our job will involve getting timely advice to homeland and national security professionals and government. Unwisely, of course, I thought this was wrong, it was crazy, so I responded in a letter to Professor LaFree's statement in footnotes, and they finally published it. And I said, among other things, LaFree's quote is emblematic of our nation's current state of affairs, which challenges a sociological imagination and is defined by the politics of fear. The recent $12 million grant to join the battle against terrorism would not have surprised C. Wright Mills, Alvin Guldner, and others who have talked about this. In his reply to me, he basically scolded me for being against research and assured me that they would speak truth to power at Maryland. On to other programs, very quickly. The Minerva Project. The Minerva Project provided the largest funding to date for social science research in support of national defense. My own university, Arizona State, was one of seven selected of 211 applicants, you can see the others there, to share funding of $51 million to pursue the topic of finding allies for the war of words, mapping the diffusion and influence of counter-radical Muslim discourse. ASU social scientists, communication scholars, and humanists involved in this pulled in over $7.5 million for this. Secretary Gates said of Project Minerva at the time, and Secretary Gates, you may recall, was a former president of Texas A&M University. And we're finding this is also a trend in the university. A lot of administrators have defense departments and sometimes intelligence ties. Henry Giroux, in his very fine book, The University in Chains, kind of documents some of this. Gates said, throughout the Cold War, universities were vital centers of new research, often funded by the government, and also new ideas and even new fields of study such as game theory and criminology. As was the case, the country is again trying to come to terms with new threats to national security. rather than one single entity, the challenge of multiple sources. And he names a number of these: disease, poverty, and terrorism. The point is that we can now put the criminology of the Cold War behind us. We now come together, unified in our joint battle against these new approaches. But with the Inerva initiative, we envision a consortium of universities that will promote research in specific areas. These consortia could also be repositories of open source documentary archives, et cetera. And in interest of time, let me just briefly hit a couple of things they do. There were three broad projects. First, the Chinese military and technology studies. Another one, the Iraqi and terrorist perspectives projects. And the third, religious and ideological studies. And part of the effort is really to analyze text and provide an understanding of jihadist radical claims and what might be done to counter those. The human terrain system is sort of connected to the Minerva Project, but they're distinct. This was something some of you might have heard about over the years. Again, something particularly of interest to anthropologists. Richard Erickson incorporated a sophisticated understanding of how media logic, especially mass media and entertainment and fear of crime, is fueled by narratives constructed by interested institutions to reflect the agendas for social legitimacy and expanded social control. And universities are now doing this more and more. The Human Terrain Program relied on using anthropologists and actually combat zones. I could probably best summarize this by briefly referring to an invitation that I was extended, probably one of several thousand university faculty members. I was asked to join it. Hi. Told me about the university. Hope you're fine. Here we go. The purpose and intent of the human terrain system is to provide commanders in the field with a social science research team that will offer expertise in sociocultural awareness and understanding using various social science research methods, as to allow the commander an alternative to force in achieving the military goals and objectives. The team composition, 5 to 9 personnel, people, a social scientist, a research manager, a human terrain analyst. At present, we're looking for individuals who possess research skills that are specifically geared in the disciplines of the social sciences. If you're interested and would like more information, da da da. And I thought, well, what the hell, I am going to retire pretty soon. Anyway. And there's some other sort of real cryptical analysis of this. The American Anthropological Association was so outraged by this because without emphasizing it too much, you can see how it violated human subject terms and confidentiality that they actually came out with a position. One thing that attracted some people to it, a small fact, is that they were paying upwards of $270,000 a year for anyone to do this, but there were certain risks. Several had been killed. One woman was burned alive, and of course the media has been very friendly with this and have not provided much serious comment. Have a couple minutes?
A couple minutes,
thank you very much. What I call a seduction of the social sciences and humanities. After 9/11, the universities were increasingly under attack because a few people were prone to speak out against some of the reactions we were having to the wars. And you know about some of these. Giroux and others suggest the university has been under the attack by a lot of right-wing critics for being much too much involved in promoting anti-American activities. As one whose courses have been targeted by the right-wing attack man David Horowitz, I can really sympathize with this very much. It's had a tremendous effect. Being involved in these activities, bringing back ROTC and so forth, has enabled universities to show the public symbolically that they are now also part of the battle, They are now on board. There is no longer any kind of a divide. And historically, the kind of critical framework that universities often stood for, especially with the social sciences and humanities, this has changed very much. So the universities are now basically removed, for all practical purposes, from highlighting the banality of evil. And more and more of these problems are cast as mere collateral damage. There's a lot of implications of this, some of which I've sort of alluded to, how the research agenda has been set more and more. There's a lot more funding available. Topics are being dictated increasingly by what we ought to study. And ultimately, we're in a situation of what I call normal terror right now, where basically the assault has been complete. Our language has now changed. We use the same discourse that much that the military uses. We are all very, very much a part of the, you know, the same battle against terrorism. And people who have cautioned about giving up that independence to commercial products such as research funded by cigarette companies, a lot of their cautionary points simply stand out and resonate with us. So the university has basically now joined forces. Something we might consider in the future. I think POGO still has a lot to tell us, and the next step should be very interesting. Thank you very much.
Thank you, David. Jonathan.
Thank you, David. Very much enjoyed that. So I take your point, which I thought you weren't going to point out, but you do very powerfully here, that there's a longer history of social sciences being quite comfortable with the military. And I would guess that World War II was sort of the high watermark of that in many ways. A lot of sociology work on the military, a whole branch of sociology that is kind of came to being around that. People like my mentor, Philip Selznick, you know, working for the Rand Corporation, writing The Organizational Weapon, a study of Bolshevism, et cetera. So there was both the World War II and the Cold War. So I guess my question is sort of, should we view sort of Vietnam and civil rights era as sort of the exceptional era that we're now returning to a sort of long-term norm, which is that the social sciences are inherently quite comfortable with power, quite comfortable with authoritarian themes in a society, sort of neo-Durkheimian sense that we ought to, you know, we have to produce social solidarity, that's part of our job? Or is there something about the war on terror that as really doing some work here? I mean, you know, during the Bush administration, the constant analogies between Al-Qaeda and the Nazis, you know, what are the differences between the Wehrmacht and Al-Qaeda? Well, you know, we could spend the rest of the afternoon talking about them. I think, you know, it was a terrible analogy. It never was appropriate. The threat was not of the same scale, even close. But ideologically, it created a moment where people could unproblematically shed their sort of pacifist, anti-militarist skin and re-engage in what we might view as sort of the long-term role of the social sciences, which is to be actually quite a conservative force of society. So I wonder about your thoughts on that. Is this a return to the long-term norm rather than a sort of exception?
I think you're on the mark, Jonathan. In a sense, I think it's a return to the norm, but there's been some important shifts. The Vietnam War era, civil rights, and so forth, really led to a kind of reflective and more sophisticated development among social sciences about subject-object connection, about researcher sponsorship connections. Some historians have pointed out some of the role of social scientists in World War II, and that some of the things maybe weren't probably quite as solid ethically as we would have liked, even though there was a big objective. After Vietnam, civil rights, the role of the government, and so forth, there became much more awareness, and I think a sophisticated dialogue and a narrative that developed about what the role of science ought to be, particularly, again, for social sciences. And being very skeptical being if not combative, at least, you know, very, very gently cooperative, sort of at an arm's distance. You got to be very careful. Project Camelot became a real spark for that when that came out and said, wait a minute, now we're actually being involved in going in and trying to shape and trying to upset revolution, upset social change and so forth. And that awareness, I think, grew, and without repeating everything I said, what happened with 9/11 and all the money is there was a real sort of gentle but concerted assault saying, we can bring these people back in and we'll make so much money available. And in a lot of these programs, especially in the cash-starved social sciences and humanities, and it became very attractive. And university administrations were also very eager to get on board with that. And so it became sort of, okay, it's no longer this uneasy tension between the military and some aspects of the university, which are kind of legitimate to have, that now became, no, we're all together now. We're all right there. So it becomes very difficult. And I've had a number of interesting conversations with some of my colleagues that are involved in these projects on my campus about that. And it's always interesting to hear them talk, well, we're not really promoting the war effort. All we're trying to do, you know, and it's sort of that constant thing. Because the money is so, and what it does for your career when you bring in $7 million grant, you know, somehow it has some, right? Please.
A follow-on question to that is, so what does it mean today for the professoriate in places like ASU and other places across the U.S.? Are there a coercive forces of deans and hiring committees and so forth that are pushing, maybe that say the younger generation beneath you, people like, so what's happening to the professoriate? Are you getting squeezed out? Are people like you able to be hired now and so forth?
I doubt very much I'd be hired now. And I'm retiring as a Regents professor, but I'd be, yeah. I think the criteria has just changed. One of the big structural changes that we're all familiar with is the emphasis on bringing in funding for young faculty. I mean, one of our deans a few years ago said the goal of graduate mentoring is to produce, I'm paraphrasing, is to produce students who can do projects that are fundable. And I wrote another memo. The idea is to produce projects that add to the discipline and da-da-da. And if they're fundable, that's terrific. But, you know, but that's sort of what's happened. And so these sorts of things come along and they become very, I think, very attractive. It become another major source of money. Indeed, it's only recently that the National Science Foundation became part of the reviewing process, which itself is interesting and a whole other topic. But the military still has sort of the strongest say over that. The anthropologists are much more aware of these things because they've been more directly involved with the human terrain. So, and I know a colleague who's done some real work leading up a subcommittee of anthropologists to oppose this. And their position is now that they oppose the human terrain system because of some of the ethical critical problems.
One last question.
Yeah, just first a quick follow-up on your question. I think you mentioned the Second World War, but the First World War, Durkheim and Bader were fighting on the opposite sides as well. But my own question is, do you know of any, you mentioned the U.S. universities, but outside the U.S., has there been any sort of concerted effort to recruit, for instance, here at UBC, there's a team of engineers who won a major grant from the U.S. to develop an unmanned vehicle for the U.S. military. And then also Naomi Klein has this thing about, in Shock Doctrine, about McGill University's psychologist involved,
yeah.
I think in the 70s, in that sort of the social science side. But do you know of any?
Well, there are some other European universities right off the top, I can't name them, who are sort of participants in the Minerva project. Okay, you know, in terms of understanding narratives and, you know, what can be done and so forth to produce counter narratives. Historically, you really touch on, again, very briefly, the big issue, the role of the professions and experts in social control of human populations, including warfare. Very specifically, with the U.S., a number of psychologists were involved in the techniques and approaches used at Abu Ghraib and some other, you know, efforts of torture that we've been engaged in over the years. And this creates a lot of major ethical considerations, which some disciplines just haven't done much.
Okay, well, I think we could go on quite a long while, but we're out of time. Thank you very much to both David and Aaron for great.